Good morning, my dear children. Welcome back to yet another session in your social science. Today, we will do Unit 3 in History, Emergence of New Kingdoms in South India, Later Cholas and Pandyas Part 4. Come, let's see the class. Before going into the session, let us see a recap of what we learned in the previous sessions. In the last three sessions, we discussed about the later Cholas, Rajaraja Chola and Rajendra Chola. We also discussed about the decline of Chola Empire. Rajaraja I was the most powerful ruler of the Chola Empire. He established Chola authority over large parts of South India. His naval expedition into the west coast and Sri Lanka brought laurels. He built the famous Rajarajeshwaram or Brigadeshwara temple in Tanjavur. His son, Rajendra Chola, matched his father's ability to expand the empire. After his striking military expeditions to northern India, capturing much territory there, he proclaimed himself as Gangaikondan. The Gangaikonda Cholapuram temple was built to commemorate his victories in North India. He also conquered the kingdom of Sri Vijaya near southern Sumatra. And the Cholas' control of the seas facilitated a flourishing overseas trade. The year 1279 marks the end of the Chola dynasty when King Maravarman Kulashekara Pandyan defeated the last king Rajendra Chola III and established the rule of Pandyas in present-day Tamil Nadu. We also learned about the administration of the Pandyas, where the system of administration was divided into provinces or mandalams, mandalams divided into nadas, nadas there were kurams, and the lowest unit of was the gramam. The local committees worked through various bodies such as Urar, Sabayar, Nagatarar and Natar. And these assemblies worked through various committees which took care of irrigation, roads, temples, gardens, revenue, etc. The Uttaremerur inscriptions give detailed explanation about how the members are to be elected and the qualifications for being a member is also inscribed in that. The Cholas gave importance to irrigation. The embankment dam built across the river Kaveri is an example. The crisscross canal Vatti Vaigal is also an example. The Chola period also witnessed the extensive construction of temples in Tanjavur, Gangaikonda Cholapuram and Dharasuram. They were patrons of learning. Chola kings were great patrons of learning. Rajendra I established a Vedic college at Ennayiram, now in Villapuram district. The trade during the Chola period was carried out by two guild-like groups, Anju Vannattar and Manigrama Mattar. We also learned about the later Pandyas. Kadankone recovered Pandya territory from the Kalabras towards the close of the 6th century. And Arikesari Maravarman was the first strong Pandya ruler to ascend the throne. He is identified with the Koon Pandyan, the persecutor of the Jains. After Arikesari, the greatest of the dynasty was the Jatila Parantaga Nedunjadiyan, the donor of Velvi Kudi plates. He expanded the territory including Tanjavur, Tiruchirappalli, Salem and Coimbatore. His successors Srimara Srivallabha and Varaguna II successively defeated the Pallavas. But Parantaka I defeated the Pandya king Rajasimha II, who fled the country in 1920, thus ending the Pandya rule revived by Kadungon. We also learned about the illustrious ruler of the second Pandya kingdom, the Sadayavarman, Sundara Pandyan. He brought the entire Tamil Nadu under his rule, which extended up to Nellore in Andhra. After the defeat of Sundara Pandyan, he fled to Delhi and took refuge under the protection of Alauddin Khilji, and this provided an opening for the invasion of Malik Kafur. After his invasion, Pandyan kingdom came to be divided among a number of kings from the main ruling Pandya family, and a Muslim state subordinate to the Delhi Sultan was established in Madurai. Now we will learn about the polity and the society of the Pandya kingdom. Now before we go into the details, let us learn what is a polity. P-O-L-I-T-Y, polity. Polity is an organized society or a state as a political entity. What is it? It is an organized society. You know, children, Pandyans had their early capital in the Korkai. But later on, they captured Madurai and they made it as their capital. And they preferred Madurai as their capital. And Madurai has been popularly venerated as Koodal. Learn the word venerated. V-E-N-E-R-A-T-E-D. Venerated. To venerate is to regard with great respect. To give great respect. That is called as veneration. And it was venerated as Koodal. The state was named as Koodal. The kings are traditionally revered as Koodal Kon or Koodal Nagar Kavalan. The state was revered as Koodal. So the king who ruled the state was revered as Koodal Kon or Koodal Nagar Kavalan. The Pandyas derived military advantage over their neighbors by means of their horses. They had the advantage over the other people because they had horses. And from there the horses came. They imported these horses through Arabs. We know it was a great port, right? We learned about the Kyle port, whom Marco Polo visited twice, isn't it? And he describes that it was full of ships from Arabia and China, and it was bustling with business activity. So that port, through that port Kyle, they had imported horse. So they had an advantage over their other people military. They imported the horses through Arabs with whom they had commercial and cultural contact. So there was the exchange of materials. They were trade, and they could import the horses which were from the Arabia. Do you know, children, the world's first constitution is Manusmriti. It contains laws regarding the society, taxes, welfare, etc. It is a poem in Sanskrit, dated back from 2nd century to 3rd century. It is a discourse or a speech given by Manu and Bhrigu on the dharmas, such as duties, laws, rights, conduct, virtues, etc. The Pandyan king claims that he was ruling according to Manu Shastra. This doctrine supports the social hierarchy in the society. A hierarchy is a rank order of people in a group or a smaller groups within a larger group. That is called a social hierarchy. In our family, grandparents have the highest rank, then our parents, then children have the lowest rank. Even though they have the highest priority, the ranking is lowest for the children. The Manusmriti says that there are five levels of caste systems. The Brahmin, who is the single spiritual power that Hindu believes lies in everything. Then the Kshatriyas, then the Vaishyas, then Shudras, then the untouchables or the Harijan or the Dalits. So these were the social hierarchy. The kings and the local chiefs created Brahmin settlements called Mangalam or Chaturvedi Mangalam with irrigation facilities. The kings and the chief had Brahmin settlements and they were called as Mangalam or Chaturvedi Mangalam. And it had irrigation facilities. It had water supply. Children, we commonly refer to the local people as a Nattu Makkal, right? The same thing is done in the ancient Pandyan dynasty also. The actual land-owning groups are described as the Bhumiputtirar, otherwise called as the Velalar. What are they called as? Bhumiputtirar or Velalar. They are owners of land. Historically, there were locals and hence they were referred to as Nattu Makkal. The communal assembly of this group is Chittiramele Periya Natar. Chittiramele Periya Natar. The assembly of this group was known as the சித்திரமேலே பெரிய நாட்டார். Children, now we will learn about the secretariat and the officials' names. The royal officials. A band of officials executed the royal orders. That is, the king's orders were executed by a group or a band of officials, people. The prime minister was Uttara Mantri. What was the prime minister called? Uttara Mantri. UTTARAMANTRI. Uttara Mantri. The historical personalities like Manika Vasagar, Kulachi Ayrer and Maran Kari worked as ministers. Who were the ministers there? That was Manika Vasagar, Kulachi Ayrer and Maran Kari. The royal secretariat was known as Eluthu Mandapam. The secretariat was known as the Eluthu Mandapam. So children, the prime minister was called as Uttara Mantri. And there were historical personalities like Manika Vasagar, Kulachi Ayrer and Maran Kari who worked as ministers. And the secretariat was called as the Eluthu Mandapam. Now we will learn about the titles of military commanders and the respected or most respected officials. The most respected officials were Maran Enan, Satan Ganapathi, Ennathi Satan, Thirathiran, Murthy Enan, Maran Enan, Satan Ganapathi, Ennathi Satan, Thirathiran and Murthy Enan. The titles of military commanders were Pallivelan, were called Pallivelan, Paranthagan Pallivelan, Maran Adithan and Tennavan Tamilvel. These were the official titles of the officers as well as that of the military commanders. Children, like the Chola rulers, they had a well-organized system of administration comprising of provinces or mandalams and nadas and kurams and gramam. The Pandya dynasty also had their administrative divisions. Pandya Nadu, as in the Chola state, consisted of many provinces known as Valanadu. It is called as Valanadu, which in turn were divided into many Nadus and Kurams. The administrative authorities of Nadus were the Natars. Natars only ruled over the Nadus. The Nadu and Kuram contained settlements. A settlement is a community or a colony where people establish their habitat, the place where they live. And the various settlements were Mangalam, Nagaram, Ur and Kudi, where different social groups inhabited. So depending on the social group, I told you they were divided into, the society was divided into hierarchy of people, isn't it? So it was divided, the settlement also were divided according to the hierarchy. Like the Uttaremeru inscription giving the village administration about the Cholas, we have inscription from Manur in Tirunelveli district dating back to AD 800 giving a detailed account of the village administration. The village administration looked similar to that of Cholas' local governance that included village assemblies and committees. Like the Cholas, the Pandyas also had local governance which had the village assemblies and committees. Children, the village was the most fundamental unit of administration under the Pandyas. And the affairs of the village were the responsibility of its elders who were not elected but recognized and appointed based on their age and status in society. Both civil and military powers seem to have been vested in the same person. Vested means officially given. V-E-S-T-E-D. Vested, officially given. So the same person was in charge of the civil duty, civil power and the military power, where they were the same person. And he was an elderly person who was having much of an experience. On the picture you can see a 12th century construction by Parakrama Pandian across the Vaigai in Madurai district, which has withstood the test of time. Still now you can see it intact. The Pandya rulers created a number of irrigation sources On either side of rivers Vaigai and Tamaraibarani, channels leading to the irrigation tanks were built. Children, the word Vaigai means way, means place your hand. Gai is your hand. So place your hand. And that river is originating in Varasandhu Hills, in the Periyar Plateau of the Western Ghats Range, and it flows through Theni, Dindigul and Madurai. So there were many irrigation projects and tanks on the either side of river Vaigai and Tamaraibarani, which led to the irrigation in that place. In the southern Tamil Nadu, like the Cholas, the Pandyas also introduced new irrigation technology. Irrigation works were done by the local administrative bodies, the chiefs and the officials. Repairs were mostly undertaken by the local bodies. Sometimes traders also dug out tanks for irrigation. They also constructed tanks for the irrigation purposes. Apart from the people, the local officials and the administrative bodies took care of the repair works. Like our panchayat system is there, panchayat takes care of the roads and the drainages and all, right? Same way, the Pandyan Tamil Nadu also had the panchayat people, that is the local administration, to take care of the irrigation, the water bodies. Pandyas followed Manusmriti in their administration, isn't it, children? Same way, they extended their patronage to Vedic practices. The Velvikudi copper plates as well as inscriptional sources mention the rituals like the Ashwamedha Yaga, Hiranyagarbha and Vijayapada Yaga conducted by every great Pandya king. Ashwamedha also means horse sacrifice. It was used by ancient Indian kings to prove the imperial sovereignty. A horse accompanied by a king's warriors would be released to wander for a period of 1 year. In the territory travelled by the horse, any rival could dispute the king's authority by challenging the warriors accompanying it. After 1 year, if no enemy had managed to kill or capture the horse, the animal would be guided back to king's capital. It would be then sacrificed and the king would be declared as the undisputed sovereign. You would have heard the story of Ashwamedha Yagna in the epic Ramayana, right, children? The Hiranyagarbha or golden womb or golden egg is the source of the creation of the universe. It was done because they believe in the rebirth of the sacrificer as a Kshatriya, even if he is not one by birth. So once they do the Hiranyagarbha, he becomes a Kshatriya. The highlight of the Vajpayee Yagna was that the performer was titled Vajpayee and was led by the king himself to be seated on the throne and was honored with the showers of various sacred objects and rice in the concluding part. So the Pandyas had the Vedic practices of Ashwamedha Yaga, Hiranyagarbha and Vajpayee Yaga. They are conducted by every great Pandya king. Children, the Velvikudi inscription is the 8th century bilingual copper plate grant from the Pandya kingdom. It has two languages, one is Tamil, another one is Sanskrit. And the inscription begins with the Sanskrit portion that invokes the god Shiva. Reverentially referred to the Pandya kings, the sage Agastya, and Hindu legends such as the Samudra Mandam, that is churning of the ocean. It records the charitable deeds, grants of villages. Then it recites four verses from Vaishnavism teaching. So you can find reference to both Saivism and Vaishnavism. So they were very much impartial towards both. And temples of both sects were patronized through land grant, tax exemption and renovation. And temples of both Saivism and Vaishnavism were given grants and exemption from tax, and they were equally renovated. Children, now we will see the effect of the Bhakti movement on the Pandyan Empire. The Bhakti movement preached using local languages so that the messages reached the masses. It brought in influential social reformation in Hinduism.
and it developed around different gods and goddesses.
The writings of Alvars and Nayarars are the best examples of literature that flourished in the period of Bhakti movement. What was the change that brought in? The salvation or moksha, which was previously considered attainable only by men of Brahmin, Kshatriya and Vaishya caste, became available to everyone. So the great Saiva and Vaishnava saints, the Nayanmars and the Alvars, combined contributed to the growth of Tamil literature and spiritual enlightenment. We learned about the Divya Prabandham by the Alvar, which was a Vaishnava poet saint, and the Tirumurai by the Saiva Nayanar poet also is an influential scripture in Saivism. The period was marked with intense religious conflicts. The Bhakti movement of time promoted the heterodox scholars for a debate. Heterodox, H-E-T-E-R-O-D-O-X, heterodox. It means not in accordance with accepted principles or opinions. It is unorthodox. So there was questioning of the normal beliefs and customs followed, and there was a debate on that. Many instances of debates of Buddhists and Jains in such debates are mentioned in Bhakti literature. So you can find in the Bhakti literature the instances of debates of Buddhists and Jains. You know, Tamil was a Hindu country. Tamil's region was a Hindu country. Even though it was a Hindu country, there were debates about the Buddhists and the Jains. The Pandya kings of the period supported and promoted both Tamil and Sanskrit. So the kings supported not only the Tamil language, our regional language, but also Sanskrit. On the picture, you can find the rock cut temple architecture of the early Pandyas in Malayadi Kuruchi. There you can see the temple and the inscriptions of the temple. There is also a Pilliarpatti rock cut temple of early Pandyas of 7th century. The Vattilithu and the Grantha inscriptions in the rock cut temples dated to 773 CE record that Satan Ganapati, an official of Parandaga Nedunchalian, excavated this auspicious temple and the auspicious tank. Children, the medieval Pandyas and later Pandyas did not build any new temples. They didn't build any special new ones, but maintained the existing temples, enlarging them with the addition of gopuras and mandapas. Children, the gopura or the entrance to the temple represent the feet of the deity. A devotee bows at the feet of the Lord at the entrance as he steps into the temple and proceeds towards the sanctum. The Meenakshi temple has 12 impressive gopuras over the three-tier prakara walls. The Meenakshi temple also has many mandabas or pillared halls built by different kings. You can see the gopura and the mandabas of the Meenakshi temple here. Children, a monolithic architecture describes buildings which are carved or excavated from a single piece of material like a rock. Rock cut buildings they are called. And these type of buildings with the pillars carved out of stones are the unique feature of the medieval Pandya style. The monolithic mega-sized ornamental pillars are the unique feature of the medieval Pandya style. The sculptures of Shiva, Vishnu, Kotravai, Ganesha and Subramaniar are the best specimens in these temples. You can find not only the sculptures of Shiva and Vishnu, even the local gods of Kotravai, regional god Ganesha, Subramaniar are also found in this temple. You can even find the Jain sculptures in it. The Kalugumalai Jain beds shown in the picture. It's a Panchayat town in Thoothukudi district of Tamil Nadu. Okay, children, they're constructed in rock cut architecture. It is an unfinished temple to be built in the reign of the Pandya kings. Children, the Madurai Meenakshi Sundareshwara temple was built by King Kulashekara Pandya. He built the main portions of the three-storied gopura at the entrance of the Sundareshwara shrine and the central portion of the goddess Meenakshi shrine are some of the earliest surviving parts of the temple. The temple has 14 gobrams, with the tallest one is the southern one with a height of 170 feet. The oldest one is the eastern one, built by the Maravarman Sundara Pandian. Each gobram is a multi-storied structure covered with sculpture painted in bright hues. The outer gobrams are high pyramidal structures, while the inner gobrams are smaller and serve as an entrance gateway to the various shrines in the temple. The temple complex has many mandabas built by different kings, and there is a place for the pilgrims to rest. There is a 100-pillared mandapa, Nayaga Mandapam, in the northeastern part of the temple. And the Pandyas patronize the Meenakshi temple at Madurai and keep on expanding its premises by adding different gopuras and mandapas. Now we will learn about the trade that had happened during the Pandyan dynasty. You can see the west coast and the east coast of Indian peninsula, and the Arab settlements on the west coast of southern India from the 7th century had led to the expansion of their trade connections to the east coast, because the government of the east coast pursued a more liberal and enlightened policy towards the overseas traders. They were more liberal towards the traders than the west coast. Their charters exempted traders from various types of port dues and tolls. They gave exemption to the duties and the tolls for the trade. So the trade flourished in the east coast rather than the west coast. The Pandyan kings had so much affinity towards the horses. They used it in battlefield as well as for procession. So in Kayal, there was an agency established by the Arab chieftain named Malik-ul-Islam Jamaluddin. And Malik-ul-Islam Jamaluddin established an agency in Kayal. And this agency facilitated the availability of horses to the Pandya kings. His agency was to just to supply the horses that was in requirement to the Pandya kings. In the 13th and 14th centuries, horse trade became brisk. Brisk means very fast. There was huge demand for horses and the trade was very much flourishing. There was brisk exchange of horses. Children, you will be knowing about Marco Polo, the well-known European to travel the Silk Road in medieval times. He was a merchant, explorer and a writer who wrote the book Travels of Marco Polo. It describes the various Asian regions and the cities that he traverses. Marco Polo and Wasaf states that the kings invested in horses as there was a need for horse for the ceremonial purpose as well as for fighting wars. They had the advantage over their enemies because they fought on the wars during using the horses. And since horses were used in not only in war but also for ceremonies, horses were in high demand, and those people who were trading horses were called as Kudre Chettis. They were called as Kudre Chettis. The people who sold or resold the horses were called as the Kudre Chettis, or the people who sell the horses. They were active in maritime trade also. A maritime trade is a kind of trade that involves the transport of goods through the sea using the ships. And it was through sea, there was so much risk involved in it. The busiest port town was the Kayalpattanam, now in the Thoothukudi district on the east coast. It was the busiest port during the Pandya time. Children, gold coins were in circulation as the trade was carried out through medium of gold. It was variously called as Kasa, Kalancha and Punna. There were even fairs held periodically in the places called Teru where the traders lived. The vast trade in horse of that time has been recorded by Wasaf. He writes, as many as 10,000 horses were imported into Kayal and other ports of India, of which 1,400 were to be of Jamaluddin's own breed. We learned about the Jamaluddin's center or agency that facilitated the availability of horses to the Pandya kings. He explains about that. The average cost of each horse was 220 dinars of red gold. So the each horse costed around 220 dinars of the red gold. With that, we come to the end of this session, children. Now let us see the summary of the lesson. The Cholas and the Pandyas are well-known Tamil monarchs. Vijayalaya revived the Chola dynasty. The prominent Chola rulers are Rajaraja I and Rajendra I. Uttarimeru inscriptions provide details of village administration. Kodankon recovered Pandya territory from Kalabras. Arikesri Maravarman and Parandaga Nedunjalian were two prominent successors. The illustrious ruler of later Pandya kingdoms were Sadayavaramban Sundara Pandian and Maravarman Kulashekaran. Maritime trade during Pandyas is highlighted by Marco Polo and Wasaf. Now we will go through the glossary. Matrimonial alliances. MATRIMONIAL. Matrimonial alliances. 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 It is a political alliances through marriage. A matrimonial alliance is a political alliance through marriage. Embankment. EMBANKMENT. Embankment is a wall or stone structure built to prevent a river flooding an area as well as to store its water. Ardent. ARDENT. Ardent is passionate. Passionate. Feudatory. FEUDATORY. Feudatory is a subordinate to another sovereign or a ruler. A feudatory is a subordinate to another sovereign or a ruler. Refuge. REFUGE. Refuge is shelter. Repository. REPOSITORY. Repository is a place where things are stored. Now let us see a recap. In this session, we discussed about the polity and the society of the Pandyan kingdom. We learned about the state, the royal officers, the administrative divisions, the village administration and the irrigation. We learned in detail about the religion and temple and trade. In the coming up session, we will do the evaluation of the book bag, question and answers. That's all for today's session, my dear children. Thank you for watching this class. Stay blessed.